Kameli Setback reporting.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining the Conor McGregor Media Conference Call. Your host for today, Matt Radmanovich with the UFC, will begin.
Thank you very much, and thank you everyone for joining. Today we'll actually be breaking this conference call in two with UFC President Dana White joining us in the second half of the call. But first, we have joining us a fighter many people call the greatest mixed martial artist in the world. Already a two-division champion in the UFC who's taken on the best in his sport, the notorious Conor McGregor leaves the octagon behind now for him to step into the ring and again make the impossible possible. Challenging an icon of boxing, the undefeated 49-0 Floyd Money Mayweather. This will be his toughest test yet. Can Conor shock the world? We'll all find out August 26th, live from the T-Mobile Arena in the fight capital of the world, Las Vegas, Nevada. Without further ado, I turn the call over to your questions for the notorious Conor McGregor.
What's up?
Ladies and gentlemen, if you would like to ask a question, please press star 1 on your telephone keypad. Again, if you would like to ask a question, please press star 1 on your telephone keypad. And I'm waiting for callers to join the queue at this
Well, no question? All right, thank you all. I'll be on my way.
We're going to the first one right now, Conor.
I do apologize. One moment. Our first question is going to come from Damian Martin. Please go ahead. Okay. Can you give me one moment while I open up this line? I do apologize for the inconvenience.
No problem.
I do apologize. Could you please press star 1 again? Ladies and gentlemen, if you would like to ask a question, could you please press star 1 again? Our first question is going to come from Dan Raphael. One moment, please. From ESPN, please go ahead.
Thank you very much. Hello, Conor.
Hello, how are you?
I'm doing great. Conor, I wanted to get your reaction today to the ruling that the Nevada State Athletic Commission made that will allow the request that you and Floyd made to reduce the size of gloves from 10 ounces to 8 ounces. Can you give me your thoughts about that ruling?
Yeah, I'm very happy with how the Nevada State Athletic Commission handled it. I think they handled it fairly. They listened to both requests and just the overall approach to the decision and the referees, the judges. I think they were very fair throughout. So that was a good thing for me, you know, to see that they're taking into consideration both fighters' requests, and I'm very happy with it.
Can you tell me, Conor, what was the specific reason that you wanted to reduce the size of gloves? I know in UFC, obviously, you wear the 4-ounce gloves. They're a little different, obviously, no fingers. Some suspect that if you wear 8-ounce in the boxing match, it would be greater for your punching power. Others surmise that perhaps it would allow Floyd to have faster hands, which he already has fast hands. What was your specific reason for wanting the smaller gloves?
I think that's... That's it in a nutshell right there. You've got pros and cons on both sides. You've got both athletes asking for the request. And then you've got me also coming up in ounces from what I'm used to. I know some in the media are like, oh, no, it's 10, it's 8. But, hey, look what I fight with. I fight in 4-ounce gloves, fingerless gloves. The knuckles are barely covered in what I am used to, so... It benefits both in certain ways. So I'm very happy with it.
What kind of gloves will you wear in the fight? What brand?
You know, we're still in discussion with that. So it's been another bit.
Okay. Thank you very much, Connor. Appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Our next question is coming from George Willis from the New York Post. Please go ahead.
Hello, everyone. Hello, Connor. Wanted to ask you, there's been a lot written about you. I wanted to know, might there be two or three things that people don't know about you that hasn't been written before?
Oh, wow. You know, I don't know. I don't know. Well, what you see with me is what you get. I am the same person on and off the camera. A lot of people like to say I'm not. Obviously, there's different moments. You'll catch me if you catch me against an opponent or someone on face. I'm a little different than. But I portray myself as who I am. So what you see is what you get with me. And there's been many articles, many stories, many things written. But you know, it's been okay. I suppose it's just I am who I am. I speak the truth for what I believe, and people portray that in many ways. So I'm pretty open, and what you see is what you get with me.
Anything like to cook? Maybe any other hobbies? Changing diapers now, lately, like that?
Yeah. I'm razor quick with the diaper changes. In fact, I'm so quick lately, you mightn't see me even change it. right now I have a nutritionist who's been with me for this camp, bringing in the weight. So that's the cooking out the window. So he's been living with me since. Wow, it must be 3 months now. We've had one hell of a camp. It's been one long stretch, a lot of hard work, a lot of dedicated and focused work. And then, of course, the nutrition has been the focus on nutrition has been top of the range. And that's why I'm in peak physical condition at this moment, 10 days out. Now we are closing in on the weight cutting phase, and then we weigh in and we fight. So that's about it. I'm out of the book. You know.
Yeah, and one more from me. How have you approached the challenge of possibly going 12 rounds in this fight?
I mean, we've adjusted certain timings in my cardiovascular preparation. We've certainly, on the endurance phases, we've stretched it out to accommodate the 12 3-minute rounds. It's actually been very enjoyable to go from 5 5-minute rounds, which is what I'm used to, which is 25 minutes, to 12 threes in the boxing, which is 36 minutes. You've got to factor in there's no not as much grappling. There is still clinch work and that, but not to the extent of a mixed martial arts belt where you can end up on your back and you've got to you've got to tactically work your way back to your feet, which is very draining. But it's a different kind of cardiovascular training. So we've adjusted some things, and I feel absolutely amazing. I've done multiple 12 round fights in the build up to this. I'd done 12 rounds just last night. We are more than prepared. My team that have formulated the McGregor Fast program. This is a cardiovascular training program that we formulated after I suffered my first defeat in the UFC to Nate Diaz. We formulated it in for the Diaz 2 rematch, and he was a triathlete with a big weight advantage, much bigger man, and can go for days. That's what he specializes in. He has a gas tank, an unrivaled gas tank. So we had to come up with a special formula and a special method to train, and that's what we're doing. And we done it, and we created the McGregor Fast program. And I've been on that since about a week after that first loss. And since then, I've had, I believe, two belts under that, and now this will be the third one. So I've been on this program over a year now, and you'll see the results. I mean, to be able to go from 5-5 to 12-3, and we've done it pretty seamlessly as well. I'm very, very, very proud of it, and I'm very excited to go in and represent the McGregor Fast program on August 26th as well.
Great. Appreciate it, Connor.
Thank you.
And our next question is going to come from Victor Mathis from the New York Times. Please go ahead.
Hi. A while back, Floyd told Fight Hype magazine, Connor talks a lot of trash and people praise him for it, but when I do it, they say I'm cocky and arrogant. I'm telling you, racism still exists. I'm wondering if you see a difference between how fans treat you and Floyd, and whether you think race plays any role in that.
Man, all you got to do is look at every single I mean, how many times have I been slated by people? It's give and take here. I get my fair share of hate and my fair share of love also. You know, I believe it's a 50-50. I mean, look at every boxing analyst, and it's like I've been discarded, and it's like I'm not welcome here. You know, I've felt it as well. So it is what it is. I don't think, for me, this is athlete versus athlete. I was upset that Floyd tried to bring this in. I thought that was a weak move on his part, when he knows and his people truly know that it's not from me. Not that am I saying that there's not people on both sides that have this mindset where it's black versus white and this type of thing, but it's certainly something I do not condone. This is athlete versus athlete, and two prime physical condition athletes about to take part in an amazing event, and that's it on my end. So I'm disappointed to hear the way sometimes it's been portrayed, but I suppose it's just the nature of the game with the way things are going on in the world at the moment. But all I can do is stay focused on my craft and look to go out and put on a great performance for the fans who are supporting this event as a whole.
Thank you.
Our next question is going to come from Rick Macy from the Washington Post. Please go ahead.
Yeah, Connor, you just alluded to this, but what do you make of some in boxing circles being so dismissive of this fight? And is that something that motivates you?
It's certainly motivating. I mean, it's the disrespect and the disregard to my skill set I look at people so many times, and they have such a their mind is closed. They've got a closed mind to how things can be done. Or it's a set way, and there's no other way. When if that was the case, we'd never have reached across the waters and searched of other land. Or we never have went into space. Or, you know what I mean? You've got to have an open mind, and you've got to realize that there are other ways, and there is a time and a place for every single move. You've got to give respect for other disciplines and other styles. Like, for instance, fighting is a complex game. There is a time and a place for every single attack and every single move. It's about finding the correct timing for it. So when I hear the way they carry on and their disregard and disrespect, you know, it is what it is. I use it as motivation, and I look forward to going in and educating. And then, but at the same time, I get it. You know, I'm coming in. I'm supposed to be from another sport, and so again, I understand where it's at. But I'm just looking forward to August 26th, going in and proving what I'm saying, and then educating the world on what martial arts is, and giving the fans and everybody a good solid fight, and earning my respect in this game also.
And as an unrelated follow-up, in the UFC, you can't always wear personal sponsors, logos, and endorsements like that. Are you looking forward to that? What do you have planned endorsement-wise for August 26th?
Yeah, I've got a couple of endorsements I've signed with Monster Energy. They've been a brand that's with me. I also signed with BetSafe. And then as far as an apparel deal, we're close to an apparel deal. But at the same time, I'm in no rush. I've got good endorsement deals. As far as in-ring endorsements, they are two that will be on the short, I believe. But look, there's so many moving parts in the game. I'm just kind of trying to roll with it. And look, it's 10 days from the fight time, so I leave this to my agency, my management agency at Paradigm Sports Management, to handle that side of the business. But it is certainly a good business. So I'm very happy with everything that's been going on the endorsement side.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Our next question is going to come from Daniel Matthews from the Daily Mail UK. Please go ahead.
Hi, Connor. I just wondered how your preparation and also the build-up kind of outside around you has differed from your big UFC fights and whether that's affected your preparations at all.
Oh, it's another day for me. It's another day of making history. It's another day of doing what I've been told I shouldn't be doing or I can't do, and then it's another mega blockbuster event. It's nothing new to me here. So the only difference in this build-up is that I have a little son now with me. So we are here in Las Vegas as a family, and my coaches and sparring partners and team, they have their multiple houses close by. So it's just been I go to the gym, I train really hard. For that given day, I come home, I rest and chill with my family, and then I repeat. And then the media and the circuits around it, it's business as usual. It's the exact same.
And just last night on Jimmy Kimmel, Floyd kind of teased the possibility of a rematch. I just wonder whether you believe him, or whether that's just kind of talk that he, the kind of thing that he mentioned about doing it in the octagon on the press tour, or whether you believe him.
Yeah, I didn't hear it. Jimmy Kimmel, I got some snippets of it, someone said, I got tagged in some stuff, but I didn't really hear much of what he said. As far as what he said on the world tour, he said he would step into the octagon. I mean, if he would do that, he would have my respect. Anyone that is willing to step into a game like that, where the limitations are so short, deserves respect. And that's at all levels, whether it's at club level in a small hall or a big stadium filled full of fans. If you get into that game, or any combat sport game for that matter, but if he was to follow through on his word on that, then great, I'll be here to grant him his rematch. But right now we're focused on putting him away August 26th. And then we'll see what happens after that. I also have multiple world titles to contend inside the Ultimate Fighting Championship, and we'll see. Maybe he can come over, and after he gets his ass whooped, he can try and challenge for my lightweight belt. I don't know whether
that
would be happy with that one. No, I don't know. We'll see what happens. And I don't know whether he's going to do. I don't think so. But it would be good.
I just wanted to... you're obviously very confident, but I wonder whether your mindset has changed at all with anything he's done, or anything that's happened in the build-up has made you, given you more confidence.
I think the team I have around me has instilled confidence in me. We have a solid team. It's been a growing team and an adjusting team throughout my career, and I think we just understand how it's done and how it's done correctly. And training's gone absolutely flawless. Everyone has a say. Everyone listens to each other. There's no, like, my word is not final. And, you know, everyone's input is there, and then we come to the best solution off of everyone's input. And it's just been an absolute amazing camp. And the work obviously has been, you know, the other night we were in the altitude chamber at like 13,000 feet at the Ultimate Fighting Championship Performance Institute, and It was a scary training session. You know, there's no way in hell that I am not ready to fight in the deepest of trenches in this contest. Like, the training sessions and the practice that we've been putting in has been to hell and back. So we are prepared for every possible outcome. I believe now the gloves are 8 ounces. I don't believe he makes it out of the second round. Part of me is hoping maybe he can last, so the word of, oh, a lucky punch or that type of thing, which I've been labelled with before, even though I've multiple first-round KOs, even though I've multiple under-one-minute KOs on my record. So part of me kind of wants to show some skill and to dismantle him that way, but I do not see it. I do not see him absorbing the blows in the first two rounds, but we are ready for absolutely every scenario. I'm ready to go to war for the full 12 rounds, and I'm ready to put him away in the first 10 seconds. So that's where my head's at.
Brilliant. Thanks very much, and good luck.
Our next question is going to come from James Dalen from Sky Sports. Please go ahead.
Hi, Connor. You said you're happy with the 8-ounce gloves. Floyd has worn 8-ounce gloves in 46 out of his 49 fights. So for that reason, was there any consideration on your part to wear 10-ounce gloves just to inconvenience his side?
No, not at all. I mean, that doesn't bother me. Again, I was already up 6 ounces from 4 to 10. So it's down a little bit from 10 to 8, so... How often he's wore the gloves or any of that never factored into. I didn't even know that, for instance, so that didn't factor into my thoughts at all. I mean, I do not care about his record. I do not care about his achievements. Every fight is on a fight-by-fight basis, so that's the way we approach it. So.
And if I can just quickly ask you about the referee, Connor, that was confirmed today. Was Robert Byrd the referee that you asked for, and what do you think he will bring to this fight? Are you happy with it?
You know, they gave us options, and we didn't necessarily ask for any referee in particular. We just there was a referee or two that gave an opinion on the fight, and it was like a little bit, you know, if that's the case, it's very hard for them to be considered. So that was where we were at with it, and then the referee. We were kind of hoping there was like a mix between an MMA, someone who had some link to an MMA bout, and I mean, Robert Byrd is a phenomenal referee. We've watched him. I've watched him ref. since the announcement has been made. He's a good ref. He lets the fight take place. He's not. He doesn't interrupt. He steps in when he should step in. And then he's also has some links to mixed martial arts. Also, his wife Adelaide Bird is involved in the mixed martial arts game. So I think it's I'm very pleased, and I think it's a credit to the Nevada State Athletic Commission on their choosing. It was done very, very fairly, so we are very happy with it.
You weren't hoping for Tony Weeks then, by any chance?
Tony Weeks was also a consideration. He was also selected. He has ref both MMA belts and boxing belts. So yeah, he was definitely one on our list also. But we are happy. We are happy with the selection.
Thank you.
Our next question is going to come from Ariel Helwani from MMAfighting.com. Please go ahead.
Hey, Connor, how are you?
Mm-hmm. What's up, Ariel?
Just wanted to quickly follow up on that. Did you have any issues with the three judges selected by the commission?
No, I didn't have. You know, I'm not going to say I haven't really studied on the judging. So it's very hard to find out like a history of the judges just yet. I believe my coach, I'm sure Coach Kavanagh, has been already on that case. But I believe it's a fair mix across the board. I believe there's U.S., there's European. I think it's I cannot commend the Nevada State Athletic Commission. They've done a hell of a job. It was fair all the way through. So we are very pleased.
On Monday, your former sparring partner, Palyman Aji, said that he is trying to fight you. That's his intention. He would like to fight you. I'm wondering if this is something that you're interested in. I know you're focused on August 26th, but even lines came out today listing you as the underdog by Bovada in this fictitious fight. Is this of interest to you at all?
Look, Ariel, tell the kid to join the queue. Tell him to shut his mouth and join the queue, will you, for fuck's sake, mate? Yeah, plugging him all over there. He got his ass whooped and he went sprinting. I don't know what you want me to say about the guy, but hey, there's a big list of people that want to get in there and try and fight me. So tell him to join the queue and we'll see what happens after the fight.
Okay. Also, have you watched All Access at all? In the first three episodes, there is no footage of Floyd hitting Mitt training in a ring. It's just him, you know, on a horse. It's him roller skating. It's him in Miami. What do you make of the way that they're portraying you and the way they're portraying him on that show?
You know, thank God I'm in the game. Well, thank God it's me on the other side. Otherwise, it'd be one hell of a boring build-up to the contest, I suppose. But I don't really care. I mean, I know he has control over it. He's an executive producer on the project. I watched episode one and I watched episode two. I thought episode two was a great episode. Episode three, I think I watched a little bit of episode three. So I haven't really... It's been okay. I mean, it's a nice dynamic. I'm in the gym scheduling full-on belts. He's at the ranch with the kids and the horse. So it's a nice dynamic. You know, he's doing one thing, I'm doing another. So that's the way they're playing it. That's the way it is. I think the build-up is the build-up. Everyone's excited here. You know, this is... We could go radio silent. We could go radio silent and this thing is still going to blow everything out of the water. The public know what they're witnessing here. This is a special historic event, and everyone is very excited about it. So that's where I'm at.
Okay, and just two other quick ones. Some fighters like Terrence Crawford and David Haye have put out videos mocking your training. Have you seen these videos? And if so, what do you make of the response to your training on Friday?
I've seen some videos. You know, it is what it is. Just been in my it's lighthearted. I don't take it personally. If anything, I see stiffness in every single one of them. You must have the limbs free. Your shoulders must be disconnected. You must have the ability to disconnect your shoulders and reconnect it at the point of impact. People are so, and with that skill set is how you can change a jab to a hook in the blink of an eye, or a jab to an uppercut in the blink of an eye. It's the same thing with the hip flexors for kicks. If I throw a teep, a front kick to your midsection, if I'm tight in the hips, in the hip, and I can't free the leg like I can free my shoulders, like I showed a one of many training methods on how to free the shoulders. If I can do that with my hip flexor, I can change the point of impact from the belly and switch it up to the head in a millisecond. This is just training methods, age-old training methods. That shoulder training method you saw was made very popular by the great Hickson Gracie, one of the pioneers of mixed martial arts. It's a shoulder loosening exercises. It gets the shoulders warmed up. You've got to do it correct, though. I've seen David Hay hit pads with it. You can't hit pads with it when the shoulder is disconnected. You hit when the shoulder is disconnected, and you'll do serious damage to yourself. And David Hay is a man who's pulled out contests over a sore baby toe, so he must be careful with the way he hits his pads. But it is what it is. I mean, again, we will educate as we go forward. It's a marathon, not a sprint. So I look forward to it.
Lastly, you said that you want to defend your multiple world titles in MMA. Do you still consider yourself the featherweight champion?
Oh, 100%. I mean, how can I not consider myself the UFC featherweight world champion and the UFC lightweight world champion? The current UFC featherweight world champion is Max Holloway, a man who I dismantled, and then the former was Jose Aldo. I mean, I still reign supreme over that division. And then also the 155-pound division, I know there's talks of an interim belt. I had only won that belt, and literally a month later there was an interim schedule. So, but, you know, it is what it is. Everyone knows I am the multiple weight world champion of the UFC's featherweight division and lightweight division, and I look forward to going back and continuing where I left off.
Thank you, Connor.
Thank you.
Our next question is going to come from Dan Rovell from ESPN. Please go ahead.
Connor, what have you heard as far as the metrics from the fight? I know that, you know, from the business standpoint, how things are going. I don't know how many updates you're getting from tickets and sponsorships and stuff like that, how much you concern yourself, but obviously money is of a concern. So how much have you been updated, and can you share anything?
I've been updated, and it's all pointing to record-breaking numbers all across the board, from the gate to the sponsorships to the pay-per-views to absolutely every angle. So I'm very, very happy with how it's going. I'm very happy with how the promotion has gone. I believe I've handled it perfectly, best of all involved, I believe, once again, from content produced, from storylines. I mean, I've been most active than all involved by a mile. So I'm very happy. I look forward to when the contest is all said and done and wrapped up. My friend is getting married in Ibiza. We are going to go to Ibiza, and then I will relax on my yacht in Ibiza, and I will begin the counting game, because that's where it counts for me. I count the deals, I'll count up the sponsorships, I'll count up the gate revenue, the merchandise sales, and all the other multiple pies that I have my hand in, and then I build up to my fortune, and there we go. So that's my plan.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to go ahead and turn the call back over to Matt Radmanovich. Please go ahead.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Connor, for joining us. And at this point, we're going to patch in UFC President Dana White to join us for the next half an hour to take your questions. So we'll reprompt you. We'll get the queue going again. But without further ado, I'll go ahead and turn it over to Dana for your questions.
I do apologize, but he dropped off of the line.
Okay. We will please everyone hold while we get Dana back on the line. Thank you for your patience.
One moment, we are about to join Mr. White.
Hi, Dana. If you're good, we'll go ahead and get everybody in the queue for questions.
He's about to join now. You may speak now.
Hello?
Dana, hey, Dana, we're going to go ahead and turn it over to questions if you're good on your end.
I'm ready.
Let's do it. All right. We'll get the queue going right now.
Ladies and gentlemen, if you would like to ask a question, please press star 1 on your telephone keypad. Again, if you would like to ask a question, please press star 1 on your telephone keypad. And I'm waiting for callers to join the queue at this present time. Okay, our first question is going to come from Dave Debert from Post Media Network. Please go ahead.
Hey, thanks for the time, guys. Just so I'm clear, is Connor still on the line?
No, I don't think so.
He dropped off. Okay, all right. Hey, Dana, thanks for taking a couple minutes.
Pleasure.
So when James Toney came into UFC, everyone agreed, or the consensus anyway, was that the result, Randy Couture winning, was pretty inevitable. With Connor going into the boxing world as opposed to, you know, Tony coming into the MMA world, why do you think there isn't that inevitability that there was when Tony came into MMA?
Well, I think a lot of people believe there is, but the difference is obviously, you know, he came into a sport where there were so many different weapons and so many different ways to beat him. Whereas, you know, Connor can punch, Connor hits hard, Connor knocks people out. Completely different. Listen, people think that Connor is going to be completely outclassed. Some people are saying that he'll never hit Floyd once. You know, I'll tell you this. I just watched him work out last night. He looks phenomenal. He's in great shape. He hits hard, and now we're fighting in 8-ounce gloves, and this is going to be a fight, and anything can happen in a fight. Even I can't remember who the boxer was that fought in MMA. He hit Tim Sylvia, former heavyweight champion, and knocked him out. So anything is possible in a fight.
All right. Is there a fight that you can remember under the UFC banner that the or at least comparable anyway, in terms of the build up, the you know, the hype, just everything that's going into this? Is there a fight that you can think of that is a reasonable comparison?
Yeah, I mean, there's tons of big fights that I've been involved with, but obviously nothing as big as this. This is the biggest event ever in combat sports history. It is the most distributed event in pay-per-view history. You can get this fight anywhere. This thing is on in like over 200 countries on pay-per-view. And, you know, boxing usually doesn't do a lot of digital. You know, you can buy this thing through UFC.tv. And, you know, it's through the Showtime app, Amazon, Sony, Apple, etc. You know, you can buy this thing. If you're in Manhattan or you're on a desert island somewhere, if you have Wi-Fi, you can buy this fight.
So what, again, off the top of your head, what do you classify as your, you know, your biggies as far as the promotion and the build-up?
Well, it depends. I mean, it depends on what time you're talking about it. Obviously, if you remember, all the Conor fights, the Ronda fights have always been big. Chuck Liddell, Tito Ortiz was big. Anderson Silva, Vitor Belfort. I mean, there's tons of big fights that had a big fight feeling. But this is the biggest fight ever. It's tracking right now to be the largest commercial pay-per-view ever done in the history of pay-per-view. It's the most distributed pay-per-view event in history. You know, the list goes on and on of records that this thing will break.
All right. Thanks very much for the time, Dana.
Thank you, buddy.
Our next question is going to come from Van Wetzel from Yahoo. Please go ahead. One moment, please.
And
your line is live, Mr. Wetzel. I'm sorry. Please go ahead.
Can you hear me now?
I can hear you.
Hey, Dana.
Hey.
Connor was talking earlier about how he sometimes, you know, envisions things or wishes people would envision what is impossible or that they think is impossible, and obviously winning this fight would be one of those to his critics. But I was wondering, you've dealt with him, and through his career he's done things like, you know, demand that he'll be the first to hold two titles at the same time. He obviously got this fight done. What is it like dealing with a personality like that where a guy's not satisfied ever and is always pushing for more and things that seem, I'm sure at some point, seemed either impossible or not allowable to you?
Yeah, I love it. I mean, that's why I call the kid the unicorn. To accomplish great things in life, you have to take huge risks. And I mean, who takes more risks than Conor McGregor? I mean, when the guy's a huge star, fight falls out a week before, he'll fight anybody. He doesn't care. He believes in himself so much that he will literally fight anybody. Most of the guys on the roster are like, yeah, I haven't trained for him, I didn't prepare for this guy, and they won't take the risk. They'll cancel the fight, and you know, that's the way most normal people are. Not this guy. You know, Floyd Mayweather, and the talk started about these guys fighting, you know, never once did he say, absolutely demand that he fights me in MMA. He said, no, I want to go and fight Floyd in his own world. I want to beat him at what he does the best. We actually have this thing that we're coming out with next week that we're going to, you know, put out on social media and other places, where Connor starts off, you know, 5-6 years ago saying, Dana, you will sign me into the UFC. I will be your biggest star. I will win 2 world titles. And all this stuff that he's laying out that's going to happen before I had ever even heard of Conor McGregor.
So just 2 quick things. Do you recall the first conversation or first time he broached the Floyd Mayweather? Can you take us to that conversation when it came up and you discussed it? And what were your thoughts at that time?
Well, I think the first time I remember the Mayweather thing was those guys were going back and forth. And I was like, this is crazy that Conor and Mayweather are talking smack to each other right now. Then Conor told me he wanted to fight him, and I was like, what? Why? What's the point in even talking about this? That guy's never going to fight in MMA. And he's like, no, I want to box him. And I was just like, all right, well, that's crazy. And again, it's one of those things I thought would never happen. You know, not forget about the whole, you know, what would the rules be, all that. I was like, we'd never get a deal done with these guys. It would be impossible to get this deal done. Then the first time this thing even started to get serious was I was on ESPN and I threw out, tell you what, Floyd, I'll give you $25 million. And then TMZ got him somewhere, and he hung his watch out the window and said, you see this watch? And I don't know what that meant. The watch was $25 million? I don't know. But that's what started the negotiations when I put out the $25 million offer.
So on all of this stuff, are you, you know, he calls himself Mystic Mac. Are you now a believer in Mystic Mac?
Oh, I'm a believer in Mystic Mac for sure. I mean, this kid, He has done everything he said he would do, and he's claiming that he will knock out Floyd Mayweather within 4 rounds, and I think he broke it down to 2 now. But listen, I'm with Connor. I'm in. I'm on the ride with him, man. So I'm excited.
All right, thanks, Dana.
Thank you.
Our next question is going to come from Rick Mees from the Washington Post. Please go ahead.
Hi, Dane. I'm wondering if you think this fight has the potential to impact the popularity of either sport. And related to that, does your research show much crossover between the MMA fan and the boxing fan?
There's some. You know, the boxing fan is older. You know, those demographics are older than ours. But I believe that this is good for combat sports. It's like when Mayweather-Pacquiao did the numbers that they did, I was like, wow. First, I said, good for them. And number two, I was like, well, that sets the bar. That shows me that if you have the right fight at the right place at the right time, you know, people are willing to watch. I knew once this thing started to materialize that this fight was going to be so much bigger worldwide than any fight that had ever happened. Conor has a very big following in places like Brazil, in places like Australia, obviously Europe. So I knew that worldwide this would be the big, and I was right. This thing is the biggest event that has ever happened in combat sports. This fight will reach over 1 billion homes worldwide.
So it could help both sports. Could it hurt either sport, depending on what the outcome is?
I don't think it hurts either sport. I think this is one of those cool situations where two guys are willing to take the risk to fight each other. And I think that, you know, this thing has captured the imagination of people. I mean, that's how this fight was built. This fight was really built through the fans and the media.
Thank you very much, Dana.
Thank you.
Our next question is going to come from Garrett Davies from the Daily Telegraph. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, Dana.
Hey, buddy.
Could I ask, first of all, has your respect for Floyd Mayweather and his team grown through this process? Because obviously you have been working very closely together now over the last kind of 8 weeks, if you like.
Definitely. The worst deals to be involved with are people that aren't very smart but think they are. They're the most dangerous kind. And Mayweather's team isn't that at all. These guys are actually very, very smart guys. And when I say that is because when problems pop up, it's always hard to fix with people who aren't too bright. Then it's always the small stuff and not the right things to be arguing about. These guys are real easy to deal with.
Secondarily, obviously the ruling by the Nevada State Athletic Commission, another first to do with the event, that they allow 8-ounce gloves just as a one-off on this occasion. What's your take on how the 8-ounce gloves will affect each man? We heard earlier, we were talking to Conor about potentially it gives him more power with his strikes, with his punches, but it gives Floyd faster hands potentially. How do you see the 8-ounce gloves affecting the contest?
I agree. I think it affects the contest a lot. First of all, yes, Floyd will be faster with 8-ounce gloves, but Floyd is a defensive master, and he has less glove for less defense. Conor hits like a truck. Smaller gloves favor him big time, so it affects the fight big time.
And from what you said just then, do you think it just marginally works in the favor of Conor then?
I think it absolutely does. Yeah, I love the fact that when we were in the original negotiations, it wasn't even something they would talk about, 8-ounce gloves. So I don't know what's changed in the last, you know, however long ago we did the deal, but I'm glad it did. I think it makes it so much more fun.
Thank you. And the final thing from me, one of the things that hasn't been spoken about much is obviously Conor has a great kind of team around him. You will have met his family and his friends, particularly his family. I mean, his two sisters and his mother and his father, Tony and Margaret. And how much do you think they have gone into making this young man? Because he's not from a ghetto. I know he's from a tough working class area, you know, rather like South Boston, where you're from Crumlin. But do you subscribe or ascribe a lot of the credit to the family for the way Conor is as well?
Definitely. I mean, you have to. But at the end of the day, he's a special kid, man. He's just I call him the unicorn. He's different than anybody I've ever dealt with. I like how he is willing to put everything on the line. I've never seen anybody who believes in themselves more than this guy does, and believes in when he makes up his mind and what he's going to do. He absolutely 100% believes it, breathes it, lives it. It's fascinating.
Final thing for me, just on that as well. What noises were you making watching him spar last night? What were the noises coming out of Dana White?
I was very quiet and sat there and just watched. And he sparred with a really fast, talented kid, and it was a good session. And Conor worked like a dog last night. He's in great shape. He's hitting really hard right now, and he's in a very good place. I loved watching it last night, and I feel good about this.
If he beats Floyd and he comes back for a couple of fights in the UFC, would it not surprise you if he beats Floyd Mayweather if he starts calling out Canelo and Golovkin?
Nothing with Conor would surprise me. That's not what I want to have happen, but it wouldn't surprise me.
Many thanks, Dana. See you next week.
Thank you.
Our next question is going to come from Dan Shapiro from the Huffington Post. Please go ahead.
Dana, can you hear me there?
Yep. Hi.
Okay, great. You know, a couple years ago when Conor fought Chad Mendes, he tried to bet you and Lorenzo a couple million bucks that he would knock Chad out. Conor's dealing with a much more serious bankroll this time around. Has he come out and tried to bet you anything that he's going to fulfill this, you know, 2-4 round prediction?
No, he hasn't tried it. Listen, I'm on his side on this thing. I want him to win. I expect him to win. I expect him to knock Floyd Mayweather out. So no, there was nothing. Not that I didn't think that he could beat Chad Mendes, but you know, it's not like I'm going to bet against another one of my guys. You know, which by the way, we didn't make that bet, but we did pay him.
Okay, and then you know, it was ruled today that you guys are going to be a an official promoter for this event. So what additional leverage does that give you guys? How else are you able to now help push this, as you said, to 1 billion homes worldwide?
Yeah, I think that we've done a good job at working with Showtime, and that, you know, they do the things that they're good at. We do the things that we're good at, and it really helped. You know, there's a lot of things that boxing doesn't do. For instance, I mean, most of the times you're dealing with a network. Networks aren't too excited to go, you know, OTT. It's not, you know, not a big thing that they're into. You know, we have the capabilities. We do it all the time, and I believe we're one of the best to do it. And, the numbers are tracking huge. We're going to do the numbers that everybody has been talking we're going to do. The line in Vegas is the over-under is 4.9 million. Everything is tracking right now to say that we're going to kill this thing. So it's looking really good.
And then a little bit off topic, now it was announced yesterday that you're going to have Tony Ferguson and Kevin Lee fight for an interim belt. That would actually fall within a year since Conor won the belt. So is there a particular reason why you guys are rushing into the interim business again?
No, because the thing is Conor has told me he's going to fight again this year. And but I don't know what's going to happen. You know, you can't put these guys on the shelves all this time. You know, we'll see what happens with this fight, and that fight's going to move forward, and we'll see what's next for Conor.
And is that scheduled to be the main event of UFC 216?
We don't know that yet. We haven't finished building the card.
Sure. Thank you.
Thank you.
Our next question is going to come from Salvador Rodriguez from ESPN Deportes. Please go ahead.
Hello, Dana. How are you?
I'm great. How you doing?
Doing good. Thank you. I have a question. How much money do you expect to Conor McGregor make that August 26th? The final number.
How much do I think he's going to make?
Yes.
Well, it depends on what the fight does. But Conor's going to make a lot of life-changing money, money that will change his family's life forever.
That's okay. Thanks so much.
Thank you, sir.
Our next question is going to come from George Willis. Please go ahead, from the New York Post. Please go ahead.
Hi, Dana. How you doing?
Good, George. How are you?
Good, good. I just wanted you to talk about the impact of social media on this fight. You're talking about 1 billion homes. That's got to have a huge impact.
Oh yeah, absolutely. You know, when we did the world tour, the numbers were off the charts. I mean, I can't quote exactly what they were. I don't have them in front of me. But if you ask our PR team, they can give you those numbers. Great question. It was incredible how many people. The first day, I can't remember. It was something crazy. Like the first day, the first stop in LA, something like 12.5 million people watched it just on our Facebook alone. Maybe it was between 12 and 20 million or something like that. I can't remember. But that was just on Facebook the first day. So, yeah, the numbers were massive.
Mm-hmm. And even something like the Pauly thing that just kept going and going and going. Do you think that added to the eyeballs you're going to get the night of the fight?
Yeah, listen, obviously the whole Paulie thing popped up out of nowhere. You know, that thing happened and went down, and it's funny all the twists and turns that happen when you're promoting a fight like this. And yeah, you know, obviously he was saying all this crazy stuff for like 5 or 6 days, and then finally I was like, you know what, I'm going to put out some of the footage here and just stop all this craziness. And when I put the footage out, I mean, just to give you another example, just the footage on my Instagram alone, it was both on Instagram are over 1 million. My Facebook was over 2 million, and Twitter was close to 2 million too, just on mine. That doesn't include, you know, everywhere else it went.
We see a lot of the things about Connor the fighter. Are there a couple of things, Connor the person, that people aren't too familiar with that stand out to you?
Yeah, I mean, Connor the person is a very loyal guy. He's a good guy. If you look at the people he's around, he's very, very, very loyal to his country and his people, obviously. And then his friends, the guys are the same guys that have been around him. He doesn't try to go, you know, maybe I should go train with this trainer or this camp or these guys. He's very loyal to his own. He's very smart kid when it comes to fighting. His fight IQ is brilliant. Then he's actually a smart businessman too. Kid's made a lot of really good decisions, and you know, even when he deals with us, he's a very bright guy.
Yeah, he likes to. Floyd likes to say that Connor stole his blueprint. Do you think he did?
Stole his blueprint? No. The thing is, that's scary. Is in a lot of ways, I think they're very similar guys. You know, it's not like you can just go out and say, "Hey, I'm going to act like this guy or I'm going to act like that guy." Connor is who he is. You know. You know, every city he goes, he's in a different Bentley or a different Rolls Royce, or, you know, so, you know, you got to be like that. Listen, I've never been in a Rolls Royce in my life. Like, one of the first ones I ever saw was Connor's in New York, you know. So you're either that type of guy or you're not.
Right, right, right. All right, Dane, appreciate it.
Thank you.
That was actually our last question. I'm going to go ahead and turn the call back over to Matt Manovich. Please go ahead.
Thank you, everyone, and thank you to our speakers today, Dana White and Conor McGregor. We look forward to seeing everybody here in Las Vegas next Saturday, August 26th, at the T-Mobile Arena for what's going to be a great evening of fights. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone, for joining. May all disconnect and have a great day.
So, there you have it. Another great video for ES News. For ESNewsReporting.com, I'm Ellie Secback, reporting. And you can follow me on Twitter, @Secback. And you can follow me on Instagram, @Ellie Secback.